So, you are given a material, for instance. Let's assume you are given a material and you are not told what the material is. And you are required to identify the material. How do you do that? And just now, because the slide is there, so you don't say X-ray diffraction, but so you can actually do by using light, the diffraction of light. So, this slide is a very informative slide which talks about resolutions that you can obtain by using different rays, right? So, the reason why X-rays are used is because the resolution that you will get is at the angstrom level, right? So, you can actually measure, resolve the distances at the interatomic planar sizes. And that is the reason why X-rays are used, right? So, this is, we can use a diffraction of light or here X-ray diffraction, and we know how diffraction occurs, right? Diffraction occurs when the wave hits regularly spaced obstacles. And if the spacing is the same order as the wavelength of the incident wave, and the obstacle when the light is hitting, if the obstacle is capable of scattering the light, only then you will have the diffraction. Otherwise, you will not have, right? So, this picture gives you a little bit more information. So, when you have two waves, wave 1 and wave 2, and then they are in phase, and their interference causes some amplification, and then you will get a resultant wave like that. But if they are in out of phase, this is a constructive interference, and this is something that we know. So, a diffraction occurs when you have something like that. So, let us say this is your atomic planes. So, the two planes of atoms are separated by a distance dHkL, where is hkL is? What is hkL? Indices of your plane, right? So, there are two parallel planes. Let us say you are shining light and the X-ray is coming. Is incident wave 1 and incident wave 2, right? And now, depending upon this distance, the diffraction happens. So, this is the diffracted beam 1 and diffracted beam 2, right? And this is the wavelength lambda. So, the constructive interference of waves 1 and 2, the wave 1 is scattered by atom P, wave 2 is scattered by atom Q. The constructive interference happens only when the path length difference, that is the path length difference between wave 1 and wave 2 is sq plus q, right? Because wave 2 is traveling by little bit more distance, that additional distance is sq plus qt. If that distance happens to be an integer multiple of the wavelength lambda, only then you will have constructive interference. Otherwise, it will be out of phase and then you will not have complete interference. All right. So, n lambda should be equal to sq plus qt. What is sq? We know the interplanar spacing. So, sq will be dhkl sin theta, right? And qt also will be dhkl sin theta. So, n lambda is equal to 2 dhkl sin theta. And you know what is your incident wavelength, right? And hence, you can calculate dhkl. What is dhkl? Interplanar spacing. If you can find out that, then that you know what is the interplanar spacing, and then from there you can actually calculate what is the initial lattice that we are talking about. I will show you one diffraction pattern, and then from there people will usually use that to identify what is the crystal lattice that we are talking about. So, these are the two guys responsible for this knowledge. William Bragg and Lawrence Bragg and Henry Bragg, both of them have same first name, right, and last name, and middle names are different. Alright, so they both were given Nobel Prize for determining crystal structures in 1915, right, both are father and son, and till date I think he is the youngest Nobel laureate at the age of 25, yeah, so So you guys still have how many years? 3 more years. Yeah? You guys have 3 more years to become youngest if you want. So do you know other father-son duos in science? Wife and husband duos? Yeah? Curie. And how about Sun Curie? You don't know? All right. In mechanical engineering, you know father-son duos? Have you heard of Bernoulli? No? Yeah? How many Bernoullis you are familiar with? Only 2. Okay. Go back and read about Bernoulli in Google. And then you will see at least 5. Okay. So, now you can use the formula that we have derived before. Right? N lambda is equal to 2d hkl sin theta. Where hkl is your Miller indices of the crystallographic plane. And for a cubic crystal system, you know that d equal to a by square root of h square plus k square plus l square. And then you substitute that in the previous formula, and then you can actually derive this relation, lambda equal to lambda by 2 a whole square. So a will be what? Lattice parameter, right? All right. So I will skip this, and then this is how a diffraction pattern look like when you do the X-ray diffraction for a given powder sample. So this is the X-ray diffraction of a polycrystalline alpha iron, X-ray diffraction pattern, and by knowing at which diffraction angle you have peaks, you will be able to figure out which material you are looking at. Okay. So there are already, suppose if you have a new material, you go there and do the experiment and get the diffraction peaks, and then there will be a catalog of diffraction peaks available in the literature, because people before us have done that job for us, and then see, compare that, and then see which one matches, and then probably your material is the one that is closely matching with the available diffraction peaks. Okay, that is how you will identify crystal structure of a material. All right, so if you have a BCC iron, how do you go about computing the interplanar spacing and the diffraction angle for the 220 set of planes? By knowing the lattice parameter of iron is 0.2866 nanometers, and the light, incident light wavelength, a monochromatic light whose wavelength is 0.1790 nanometers. Okay. So the DHKL is A by square root of H square plus K square plus L square, and the lattice parameter is this guy. And HKL, that is the set of planes, then interplanar spacing is 0.1013 nanometers, right? And then the diffraction angle will be 62.13 degrees. So when you do the X-ray diffraction experiment, if the incident wavelength is this, then you will see a peak for 220 at diffraction angle of 62.13 degrees, right? That is how we can actually back them, and then you will be able to identify the details of the system. Okay. All right. So there is a lot of information available online. One source, the Cambridge source that I have mentioned to you in the previous lecture. Wikipedia has several detailed instructions. And the YouTube links that I have shown you, please go through them. And also, of course, you should read the textbook. Right? So, with that, we will close the topic of crystal structure.